Okay, hello everyone. Yesterday when we stopped, we were having a discussion on context switch and particularity of context switch, and we also discussed the concept of giving up CPU by a process. So most typically when a process does a system call like read, then you know it will basically give up the CPU because the IO is yet to complete. Let me start my video as well. Yeah. So today what we are going to see, we are going to understand all the things that we have studied so far in the x86 code. So we are first of all going to begin with how hardware interrupts, traps, exceptions, they are handled. Okay, how system calls are handled. We are actually going to see the exact flow of code, you know, in handling all of these, the software interrupts, the hardware interrupts and so on. Then we will see the specific case of a timer interrupt. Because we know that the timer interrupt basically allows the scheduler to run. And then we will also see some details of how scheduling takes place. And then we will understand, you know, how a blocking system call, for example, read or write, which do some IO, they basically block and basically how do they give up the CPU. So we are going to see all these details. Now we'll begin with, you know, understanding of handling traps. So, we understand that, you know, there is a transition from user mode to kernel mode in three cases. Okay. The first case is when there is a system call. Okay. The second case is when there is a hardware interrupt. The third case, which we actually did not discuss much, was if the program does something illegal, for example, division by zero. If there is a machine instruction being executed, which does a division by zero, then also the hardware mechanism built in into the CPU will create what is called as an exception situation, and that will also again switch from user mode to kernel mode. In all these three cases, not only the user mode changes from kernel mode, but also the control is supposed to jump to a predefined location. The program counter is abruptly supposed to change to a predefined location, and obviously we now know what will be there at that predefined location is the OS code. Because when the OS was loading, it occupied all those locations. Today we'll see in x86 code how does OS take control of all these locations. We'll see that today. Now, what is needed to be done? Okay, when you know such situations occur that you change from user mode to kernel mode. So basically, the thing which most of the kernels actually do is not only you know they have their code at these predefined locations, but the code which is executed on changing from user mode to kernel mode and while executing a system call or hardware interrupt, it's that the stack pointer is also changed. The value of the stack pointer is also changed to point to a location which basically is called a kernel stack. So what is kernel stack? It is just some location in memory and the stack pointer is made to point to it, because in registers there is only one stack, right? Now, why there is a separate kernel stack? You know, why can't the kernel run on the same stack that is being used by the user process? It can. This is actually technically from the perspective of executing the code, there should be no problem. So what I'm trying to say is, let us say your user process was running and let us say main called function F, F called G, there was a timer interrupt, you jump into kernel code. The kernel code can actually keep calling functions using the same stack that the user process was running. But then what will happen is that the kernel code and the user code, they are both, you know, using the same stack. Now, this now creates a security problem in the sense that if there is a cleverly written user code, then it will be able to access the kernel stack also. And then it can lead to potential security breaches with the system. And that is why kernel code often runs on a different stack. Okay. We will see now how all this happens. Okay, we'll see it with respect to some code. Now, obviously, if there's a hardware interrupt, then the kernel will have to check, you know, which device did the hardware interrupt and then do some, you know, work with the hardware device, because hardware interrupt basically says that the device is requesting something to be done. And so the kernel will have to handle that. Now, actually, what actions are needed, you know, on a hardware interrupt or a software interrupt or an exception? Basically, it is needed to save the registers, that is the context. So that the processor could have been running a process And if there's an interrupt or a trap, you are going to jump into kernel code. So whatever context the process had, that is the set of registers that the process was using, will have to be saved. We know where it will be saved. It will be saved in the PCB. After that is done, then you have to basically start running the kernel code. And that means the kernel context, you know, has to be loaded in the registers, and kernel stack has to be set up so that the kernel code runs on kernel stack. And then the kernel has to run in appropriate place. So if you, it was a system call, you have to make the proper function call, you know, for example, for read and write and open and fork and exit, the proper function has to be called. If, you know, you came here because of an interrupt handler, then you have to call the appropriate code in the kernel to deal with that appropriate device, for example, keyboard input or disk IO and so on. And in order to do that, the kernel should be able to get all the information related to the event. For example, which IO completed, which system call was called, which process did the exception, and so on. So all this code needs to be written in the case of a code in the kernel, which is going to handle a trap. Now, coming back to some basic concepts. We have seen the concept of privilege levels in CPUs, okay? Now, it so happens that the x86 processor has four levels, not two. Those levels are numbered 0 to 3. But in practice, most operating systems use only two levels, that is 0 and 3. So 1 and 2 are ignored. Although they exist in the hardware, they are not used. So 0 is called the kernel mode and 3 is called the user mode, respectively. So now, I hope you understand, when we say kernel mode in x86, we are referring to the privilege level 0. So basically, there will be two bits because there are four values, right? So there will be two bits in some register. If they are set to 0, then the processor is operating in kernel mode. If they are set to 1, 1, then the processor is executing in user mode. Okay. So the particular privilege level at which you are currently executing is actually stored in the CS register. Okay. In the CS register, there is a field called current privilege level. There, this value is actually stored. Now, the privilege level will automatically change when there is an INT instruction, or if there is a hardware interrupt, or if there is an exception. Okay, the privilege level will change back if you execute an instruction like irate, return from an interrupt handler, irate. So when you run this instruction, the privilege level will change again back to user level. Now, in x86, 32-bit, if you say INT 10, it is basically going to cause the interrupt number 10. The hardware interrupt number 10. And so basically this instruction actually can also be used to stimulate the creation of hardware interrupt number 10. Remember, the way hardware is set up, the way your IO devices are connected to the processor, that also creates the same effect as if, you know, a particular hardware interrupt occurred. So there are two ways this can be simulated. So that is, you know, by actually calling INT with some particular number, or actually some hardware device raising a hardware condition, some electrical signal on some particular wire, and that way also the kernel will get interrupted. The point I want to make is that in both the cases, the kernel will behave in the same way. So the programmers have a lot of flexibility in deciding how to use the INT instruction. Now what XV6 does is, it actually uses the number 64 for the system calls. It says that, you know, INT 64 will be used for making system calls. Now let us try to understand how the interrupts are actually handled. And I'm sure you have studied something about the interrupt descriptor table. So what I'm doing is just a revision. We are basically going to refer to the 32-bit version of the x86 processor and the interrupt descriptor table in the context of 32-bit. Now, let me first of all mention that the interrupt descriptor table is basically an array in memory. Okay, I'll repeat. It is an array in memory. Okay, and if it is an array in memory, obviously everything that is in memory has to be filled in by some code. Because when you turn on your computer, the RAM is empty. The RAM has nothing. So if you want something to be there in the RAM, then it has to be filled in the RAM. Okay. So it is actually the job of the operating system, when the operating system itself is getting loaded, to actually fill up the entries in what is called as the interrupt descriptor table. So it is this table which actually defines what we call as interrupt handlers. Okay. So there are 256 entries in this table, and every entry is basically giving us a code segment and instruction pointer pair, which is to be used when handling a corresponding interrupt. So basically, we will be able to handle 256 different type of interrupts, and the interrupt number will actually be used as an index into this table. And when you access that entry in this table, which is basically an array, then you will get a pair of code segment and instruction pointer. And obviously, you know, memory is addressed using code segment and the offset within the segment. So instruction pointer is that offset. So together they will be used to access the code which is to be actually run when a particular interrupt occurs. Now it so happens that here interrupt 0 to 31 are defined for software exceptions like divide errors or attempts to access invalid memory address and so on. What XV6 does, it will map the 32 hardware interrupts to the range 32 to 63, and it will use the interrupt number 64 as a system call interrupt. So we will understand it more when we actually see some code. Okay, so in XV6 code, there is this structure called a gate descriptor. Okay, the gate descriptor, as you will see, uses the particular C feature of bit fields. So what is being said here is that this particular field of 150 is a 16-bit field. This particular field args is a 5-bit field, not byte. It is a 5-bit field. Similarly, RSV1 is a 3-bit field and so on. If you actually count all these values that are here, you will notice that 16 plus 16 is 32 plus 1 more 16. And if you sum these up, 8, 4, 12, 13, 15 and 16. So total, this is a 64-bit entry. Okay, it is a very precisely calculated and constructed structure. The very definition of this structure is actually borrowed from the way Intel defines an entry in the interrupt descriptor table. This is all documented in the Intel manuals. Okay, Intel publishes huge fat manuals to describe what their processors can do, and in that they describe how an entry in the interrupt descriptor table should look like. And this structure, XV6 code, is actually designed looking at the Intel manuals. Okay, so the entries here are basically those entries. The interesting entries for us are this code segment, which is basically an index into, if you remember, what was called as the global descriptor table. And remember, we will revisit the global descriptor table in coming few weeks. And this offset and this offset together basically give us the particular address, okay, at which the desired code is. We will right now ignore some other fields, because to understand them, we have to understand also the memory management in detail. But I think as of now, it is sufficient for us to know that the IDT will basically be an array of such 64-bit entries, and every such 64-bit entry will give us an offset. Okay, the offset is going to be stored in these two entries. Okay. Now let us go to the XV6 code again and try to understand how the interrupt descriptor table gets set up. Meanwhile, let me check the chat. Okay, no questions in the chat. Any other questions that you have? All right. So I'll go to now the XV6 code. So I'm going to browse again using Cscope. So what was the last XV6 code that we saw? The last XV6 code that we saw was actually the bootloader code. And let me go to the boot main.c file. And we were here in boot main.c, if you recollect. And we saw that this boot main code is called by the bootloader. And we said that here the kernel is read from the disk and loaded into memory. Then, because the kernel code itself is an ELF file, every section of the ELF file is read in turn. And then the particular value called entry given in the ELF file is read. A pointer, this is a function pointer actually, entry is a function pointer, is given this value, the value of the variable entry. And basically that value is used as a function pointer, and jump is made to the function called entry. So this entry is actually the entry to the kernel code. What we have here in bootmain.c is basically the bootloader, which is loading the kernel. And the kernel code basically starts with the value given in this variable called entry. The variable entry is itself present in the ELF file. Okay. So the that particular variable gives us the location of the kernel code in memory. And then you jump to this entry, the code called entry. So where is this entry now? So there is an entry.s, and in entry.s, you will see the symbol entry. So this is where the kernel code actually begins. Okay. Now we will skip this assembly code. It is basically some memory management code. Okay. Because even before the kernel starts running, it has to do some hardware setup to actually access the memory. So you will see that the last part of this code is this. The symbol main is moved, the address of main is moved to EAX, and you jump to the address given by EAX. So basically you are jumping to the code given by this main. So let us go to main. So there are now, you'll see so many mains because there are so many user programs, and each of those user programs here actually contains a main. So we get to see a lot of mains. Let me here go to the definition of main. So as you can see, cat.c, echo.c, these are all user land programs, right? So I'm not interested in all these user land programs. As I know, because of my reading of the code, this is the main I'm interested in main.c. So this is a kernel code. Okay. Now you will see that what this main does is it calls lot of init functions. So basically the kernel is initializing lot of hardware, initializing its own data structures, kernel's own data structures, so that, you know, the kernel can work properly. The particular code that we are right now interested in is this TV init, trap vector init. So let us go to trap vector init. So remember, how did we come here? The bootloader loaded the kernel and jumped to the code of entry, entry called main, main called TV init. I'll repeat, bootloader loaded kernel and then jumped to the code of entry, entry called the function main, the function main called TV init, and we are in TV init. So let us see now what is happening in TV init. Okay. So in TV init, you will see that there is a loop, the loop which runs 256 times, and it basically uses this set get. And let us see first what is the set get. Set get, as you will see, is a macro, a hash define, which takes these five arguments. But then this is a multi-line macro. The expansion of the macro is written on multiple lines. So what is happening here is that this gate basically is referring to a structure, and obviously these are structure elements, and the different elements are given values using these four parameters. Okay. So this refers to an entry, okay, of the type get descriptor, and these four are basically used to set values in the get descriptor entry. And now what is a get descriptor? This is the IDTI. This IDTI is nothing but this global variable. And now we have seen what is the struct get descriptor. I already showed you this get descriptor on the slide. This is nothing but actually the particular way an entry in the interrupt descriptor table should look like. So basically the interrupt descriptor table is this. This is the interrupt descriptor table. It's a global variable. So remember, when the kernel was loaded in the bootmain.c, this IDT also occupied some space in memory, because this IDT, it's a global variable. So this global variable must have become a part of the file called kernel when the code was compiled, because global variables occupy space in the object code file. And that is why when the bootloader loaded this kernel file, the IDT array also occupied space in the memory. What you are doing here is simply setting values in the IDT array when the kernel code is running. So what it is doing, it is filling in every entry in the interrupt descriptor table. Now what you will notice, now the interesting thing here is this field called vectors I. Vectors I. So let us once again go to setget, and you will notice that the vectors actually become so offset, and the offset is used to set the value here and here. So the first and last bit, which basically gives the location of the code that is to be executed. So basically, what is happening here, for all the 256 entries in the interrupt descriptor table, the offset is specified to be the one given by this array vectors I. Now, what is this array vectors I? Here you will see it is declared that the vectors is an array which is external to this file. So where is that array? That array is declared in vectors.s. So let us go to vectors.s. Vectors.s is an assembly code, and if I go to the bottom of this, okay, this is the vectors array. What is the vectors array? It is actually an initialized array with vector 0, vector 1, vector 2. All these values are actually mentioned here, okay, up to vector 255. So what is a vector 0 or vector 1? These are actually addresses of labels like this. So you can see this is a label vector 254, vector 255. Similarly, all you can see is, you know, all these values from vector 0 to vector 255. So let me just go to vector 0. So remember, vector 0 is an address. Vector 0 is a label in assembly code. So it is basically an address. So the vectors array is basically an array of addresses. The address of vector 0, address of vector 1, address of vector 2. So what is vectors I now? Vectors I will refer to a particular location. For vectors 9 is this value. Vectors 9 is this value. What is this value? It's an address. So every vectors I is an address. Okay. So what you have is actually this address in the vectors array. You have this address in the vectors array. You have this address in the vectors array, and so on. So what is happening right now, that the IDT table is being filled with the addresses given by the vectors array. So it is basically being initialized to vector 0, vector 1, vector 2, and so on. That is what is happening in this particular piece of code. Right? Any questions? Any questions? I must advise you very, very seriously that after this lecture, all of you should spend considerable time in reading the code I have shown to you. And you should do that immediately today only. Because afterwards, we are going to see lot of more code, and you will start feeling lost if you are not keeping track of the code that we are discussing in the class. And not only you should keep track, you should also try to memorize, internalize the code that has been discussed. So I'll wait for a few seconds to check if you have some questions. Okay. So the vectors, I'm repeating because there's a request. There's a file called vectors.s. It's an assembly code file. Okay. In this file, there is this label called vectors. So this is basically the array. So remember, this is the assembly code file. It will be actually assembled and assembled to a object code file. Okay. This file will be assembled to a object code file. This is a C code file. It will also be assembled and converted to an object code file. Then this trap.c and this vectors.s will get linked together. So the linker will also, linker links, we said that it will link the function calls with the code of the function. It will also link the accesses to global variables across different files. So the linker will actually resolve this vectors, that is the vectors declared here to be extern, with this vectors. Okay. So that is the job of the linker, to connect these two symbols called vectors together. So when you say vectors I here, okay, that vectors I is nothing but one of these. So vectors 4 is this, vectors 10 is this, and so on. Now what is vectors 4? Vectors 4 is basically the value. Long means it's a 4 byte. The dot long basically says take 4 bytes. So it is this value vector 4. What is vector 4? Vector 4 is this label vector 4. So it is basically a label in assembly code. So it's an address. So whatever is the address of this vector 4, whatever is the address of this vector 4, okay, is actually copied here. So the vectors array is nothing but an array of addresses. Vectors array is an array of addresses. So what is happening here? address of vector 0 location, vector 1 location, vector 2 location, up to vector 255 location, that is being used. That is being used in setget as an offset. That value will go into this field and this field in the IDT array. So basically, you are initializing the IDT array, the IDT table. This IDT table is getting initialized to point to different locations. Okay, that is vector 0, vector 1, vector 2. It is being initialized to point to these different vector locations. Is that okay, Nachiket? Okay. Any other question? Fine. You will notice that there is one line which is outside the loop, and it is also called to setget, but it is setting the index number t syscall. Now, what is t syscall? 64. This line is 64. So remember, I said the number 64 is used for software interrupts. So the interesting thing is that the same interrupt descriptor table is used to handle hardware interrupts, software interrupts, and exceptions. Okay. So the value 64, the only difference you will see is instead of this 0, this is 1. And this is vectors t syscall, which was not needed, but instead of the 0 here, there is a DPL user. Okay. So what is being done is that the particular entry, that is the entry number 64 in this array, is being set up specially to have this value as 1 and this particular last value as DPL user. So let us see the last entry in setget and the second entry in setget. The second entry is istrap, right? And the istrap is being used here. So, and the value D is actually being used here in the DPL. So this particular values will be used to set the particular values in the interrupt descriptor table. What is the significance of these two values? We will soon see. Okay, when we start seeing what is the way this particular interrupt gets handled. So what we saw is that a special entry is made into the IDT for software interrupts. And then let's ignore this init log. This is of no concern to us right now. But basically what happened here in TV init is an array of entries of the type get descriptor got initialized. That's it. Now, does this mean that the interrupt handling is set up? No. All that happened is that the in-memory array IDT was set up. Let me go back to main. Okay, let me go back to main. You will see that this TV init is over, and after that, you know, some other functions are getting called. Okay, B init, file init, ID init, etc., etc. One more function. Let us go to TV init. One more function, and that is actually this ID T init will get called from main. So how will that get called? Okay, sorry. Let's see who is calling IDT init. You will see IDT init is getting called from MP main. Let's go to this too. So IDT init is getting called from MP main. And let me see who is calling MP main. MP main is getting called from main. So you will see this is the main function once again. After TV init, finally it will call MP main. MP main here will call IDT init. What is IDT init doing? IDT init is calling the function LIDT, passing it the argument, the array IDT. What is LIDT doing? You will notice that it is calling the assembly instruction called LIDT. So this is actually the instruction to load what is called as the IDT register. The IDT register is made to point to the location of this array in memory, the IDT array. So after this, actually, we say that the interrupt descriptor setup is complete, because it is the job of the IDT register to point to the location of the IDT table in memory. So after this particular pieces of code is over, the setup of the operating system for doing interrupt handling is over. This is the code that we talked about when we said the OS occupies all hard interrupt locations. Okay, this is the code through which we say the OS takes control of the hardware. Because whenever now there is a hardware interrupt, whenever there is a hardware interrupt, what will happen? Let's try to understand it through a diagram. Okay, whenever there is a hardware interrupt, I did not copy that diagram. So, but let me try to show that to you, that diagram. I should have copied it actually, but that is fine. I'll show to you right now. Give me a second. Looks like I deleted it, huh? That's quite bad. Okay, one second only. Fine. So what I'll do, I'll show you how it is done. So this is the processor. This is the CPU, right? Inside the CPU, there is a register called IDTR. Okay, IDTR register. So this is the register, IDTR register. This IDTR register is pointing to the IDT in memory.
Hello.
So this is the IDT. Yes. IDT. Yes, please speak. So this is the IDT in memory. The IDTR inside the CPU is made point to this table. Whenever there is a hardware interrupt, because the IDTR is inside the CPU, it is a register in the CPU. The CPU will consult to this IDTR on any exception or software interrupt or hardware interrupt. Will consult this in order to jump get the address of the IDT. Yes, go ahead, please speak. Those push instructions in vectors, we are coming to them. Just wait, Nachiket. We are coming to those push instructions in vectors.
Sir, can you just repeat the last function that you went through in the code?
Yeah, I'll do that. So what I said is that from bootloader we come to entry, from entry we come to main. Main will do lot of things, but it will call TV init. TV init will basically set up the array called IDT. In that array, it will fill in all the code offsets, okay, which basically correspond to different pieces of code to be executed on different hardware interrupts or exceptions or software interrupts. What are those offsets in vector 0, vector 1, vector 2, vector 3? What are those offsets? They are basically locations of different codes to be executed on different hardware interrupts, software interrupts or exceptions. So, but here you are only setting up the array in memory. Afterwards, you call MP main, and MP main will call IDT init, and IDT init will call load IDT. And load IDT will basically run the instruction LIDT. Remember, it has been passed the address of the IDT array. This is the IDT array. What it will do is, it will basically load the address of the IDT array in the IDT register. After that, the IDT register, so this is the IDT register in memory, it is going to store the address of the IDT. So basically we say it is a like a pointer. Okay, so it is going to point to that. That is what is going to happen. So once again, revising this, the struct get descriptor is nothing but the format of an entry in the IDT. Here you repeatedly call 256 time to set up an entry in the IDT and a special line of code to set up the 64th entry to correspond to the system calls. The setget code we have seen is like this. The vectors.s, okay, the one file which we have seen just now, is basically having the addresses vector 0, vector 1. These are the addresses which were loaded in the IDT entry. Fine. Now let us try to understand what will happen on interrupt. Okay. So TV init is TV init. We are here. After TV init, we said that the vectors will be used, vectors.s. Sorry, yeah. So what now happens when there is a hardware interrupt? When there is a hardware interrupt, remember it's a hardware interrupt. So whatever I am saying now is all a hardware mechanism. So there is an IDTR in the CPU, right? And this is the CPU. Forgive me for my bad drawing. This is pointing to the IDT table. Remember who did all this? This was all done by the operating system code when the operating system code was loading itself and the main function was running. Now let us say there is a keyboard key pressed. The keyboard key pressed will basically correspond to some interrupt number. Let us say interrupt number 23. Now, no matter which interrupt it was, 23 or 25 or 100 or number 64, or let us say a user code did a INT 64 instruction, or there was a division by zero while executing a user code. In all these cases, what will happen? The normal execution of CPU will get interrupted. What the CPU will actually do is it will consult the IDTR register. And because of the particular interrupt, it will know which interrupt, 0, 1, 200, it will know that interrupt. That interrupt value will be used by the CPU in hardware. Remember, no instruction is running right now. This is happening in between execution of two continuous instructions. Whatever I am describing right now is happening in between execution of two instructions because there was an interrupt. Always remember, interrupt can never occur in the mid of executing a machine instruction. It is only handled at the end of executing a machine instruction. So earlier, if you are running, let us say, a move instruction, the move instruction will complete and then the hardware interrupt execution will start. Hardware interrupt handling will start. What will happen as a part of that? The processor will consult IDTR, use the interrupt number as an index into this array. It will now get this particular entry. When was this entry set up? It is the entry in the IDT array, the 64-bit entry. From this, it will actually take the value of the code segment and the instruction pointer. And remember, the code segment is a register here. And the instruction pointer is another register here. So these will now get loaded with the value specified in the IDT. And what are the values in CS and IP? Remember, the IP is going to contain the address of vector 0 or vector 1 or vector 2 and so on, right? So now, because this is the instruction pointer, it will contain the value of either vector 0 or vector 1 or vector 2 and so on. Now, what is the code of all of them? You will notice that the code of all of them is almost very close. You know, all it is doing is, it is first pushing 0, then pushing another number, that is 1, 2 or 3, as you can see. Vector 3 pushes 3, vector 2 pushes 2. But all of them first push a 0 and then all it does is jumps to the label called all traps. That's it. So let us go to all traps. Okay. So let us jump to all traps. Okay. I don't know why I'm not able to do this, but that's fine. Vectors.s and all traps label. All right, I am surprised. Okay, I know why I am not able to do this. I did my syntax improperly. Let me run my ctags. Yeah. Now I think I can jump to all traps. No? Let me now try to jump to all traps. Yeah, I can jump to all traps now. So all traps is in trap asm.s. So after pushing 0 and pushing a number corresponding to that particular interrupt, you jump to all traps. All traps does a push of few more things, lot of push on the stack. It is now going to move some values in the DS, ES, AX register, some pushing more onto the stack, and then it is going to call the function trap. Remember, it's a call instruction. So call instruction, as you know, will push this value, address of this particular instruction, on the stack and then jump. So the return value gets pushed on the stack and then this jump happens. So let us try to understand what is happening in all these pushes first. Okay. And this is a very important point to understand what happens in this particular piece of code. Whenever there is an INT instruction or hardware interrupt, the CPU does this first. As I said, it will face the nth descriptor from the IDT, where n is the argument to int. It will now check a very important thing, that the current privilege level in the code segment is less than equal to the DPL, that is where DPL is the privilege level in the descriptor, the descriptor privilege level. So remember, when we did this setgate, TV init, when we did this setgate, an entry in the get descriptor was this DPL, the descriptor privilege level. So some value was stored here, right? So this is the new level, privilege level to be assigned to the CPU. What is the privilege level we are passing all the time in setgate? So DPL is basically this D. D is this last value. You will see it is 0. So what we are saying is that the privilege level of the CPU should become 0 every time. But here we are saying DPL user for a system call. So that is basically 3. So the difference is in the value is 3 for system call, but for all other exceptions, it is 0. So what is being checked, that the current privilege level at which the CPU is running is less than equal to the DPL, okay, where DPL is the privilege level in the descriptor. Now what you want is, if there is a 0 in the code segment, that means the CPU is already executing in kernel mode, then you can switch to it from the user mode. That is possible. Now what happens, okay, what happens now in hardware, and that is not actually written as a part of instructions that we have seen just now, is that the stack pointer and the stack segment, okay, will be saved in the CPU internal registers, but only if the target segment selector's privilege level is less than the current privilege level. So only in this particular case, that is, for example, if the current privilege level is 3 and the target level is 0, so you are basically going from, let us say, user mode to from kernel mode to user mode, only in that case they will get saved in some temporary variables. We can ignore this point as of now, okay, because we are mostly coming from user code to kernel code. So switching from user mode to kernel mode, okay, and here it will actually save the codes stack segment and the ESP. Now there is another descriptor called as the task segment register in the x86 processor. The value of the stack segment and the stack pointer will be loaded from the task segment descriptor. Remember, this is going to happen in CPU, in hardware, without executing any instruction. All this is happening in between execution of two instructions, and all this is happening through a hardware mechanism. So essentially what is happening, that the stack pointer is getting changed. The stack pointer is getting changed to a new location, which is given by the task segment descriptor. So obviously the task segment descriptor should have been set up initially to point to what is called as the kernel stack. Okay. The task state descriptor is actually on the global descriptor table, and the index is given by the TR register. When we see, you know, sometimes later the memory management code of the OS, we will also come to see when during the initialization, that is during the main function itself, all these values get set up. Now after this, okay, the stack segment gets pushed, the ESP gets pushed. Okay, these two are optional. Okay, these two are optional. It is not mandatory that these two get pushed. And the changes actually happen to the stack segment and ESP using task segment descriptor, as we have seen in this particular piece of code. Then the E flags, you know, there's an E flag register that also gets pushed by the CPU on the stack. The core segment gets pushed and EIP also gets pushed, because see, you are changing whatever you are executing, you are going to stop that execution. So obviously, what you were executing earlier needs to be saved somewhere. So it is basically going to be saved on the kernel stack, because remember, the stack pointer had changed to the kernel stack. These two values are actually now the values of the older stack. So the E flag, which is a particular register in the CPU, which is storing certain values, is also pushed. The code segment EIP, they are also pushed. The IF bit in E flag is also pushed, but that is going to happen only if there was an interrupt, the interrupt flag bit. Now the code segment and EIP are set to the values in the descriptor. So before they are loaded, the CS and EIP, they are loaded from the values in the GDT, the IDT. All these things are done in the CPU and hardware. So basically, five things have been pushed onto the stack. Now just remember, the IDT was already set from using values from vectors.s. When you, let us say, do a system call, then what will happen? Zero will be pushed onto the stack. When? After the five things were pushed. After these five things were pushed onto the stack. These five things were pushed onto the stack in between execution of two instructions. Now the core segment EIP are set to point to the new values. That is this location. And now you will push 0 and 64. So what will the kernel stack contain now? Stack segment, ESP, E flags, code segment, EIP, then 0, and then 64. We will see the purpose of 0 later on. This 64 is obviously to identify the interrupt. Okay. And then you jump to the code of all traps. What is all traps going to do? All traps basically pushes the data segment, extra segment, FAS, and GS. So all these values are pushed onto the stack. Then it does a push L. Push L will push all general purpose registers onto the stack. So what will the stack contain now? The five things that we talked earlier, 0, then 64, then DS, ES, FS, GS, and then general purpose registers, EAX, ECX, EDX, EBX, OESPP, EBP, ESI, EDI, all of them will get pushed. Okay. All of them will get pushed onto the stack. Now, why? The question is, why all of these things have been pushed onto the stack? Why have all of them been stored onto the stack? Okay. Now, obviously, there is a purpose for each of them. For example, why was the code segment EIP pushed onto the stack? Because when you return from this interrupt handler, you should resume the code which you are executing earlier. And this code segment value and EIP value, which is onto the stack, will give you the location where you have to jump. That is why they have been pushed. Why 64 pushed? Maybe it will be used in further code to indicate, you know, which particular interrupt handler we are in. Why are these registers pushed onto the stack? Most probably because they were used as general purpose registers by existing code, and they will be also used by the later code, and that is why they are likely to be overwritten. So let us store them onto the stack. This particular set of values, okay, this particular set of values which is pushed onto the stack is the structure trap frame in the code of x86, and we will revisit the structure trap frame sometimes on very soon. After this, what is happening now? Some particular piece of code, some value is getting moved to the data segment ES. Now I hope you realize why they were pushed onto the stack, because you are changing them immediately here. Then the stack pointer is also pushed onto the stack, and the function trap is called. Okay. Remember, when the function trap is called, this, the return value of this instruction will be pushed onto the stack. So let us go to the function trap. Here is the function trap. Okay. You will notice that the argument to this function is a struct trap frame pointer TF. Now see, if you can now recollect the calling convention. If you now can recollect the calling convention, all trap. Let me go to all traps. Before you call trap, the stack pointer value was passed. What is the stack pointer value? The stack pointer value is basically the address of all this, right? The stack pointer value as of now is the address of all this, because these things are on the stack. So when you push the stack pointer, you basically push the address of this particular last thing onto the stack, right? And then you call trap. Now, what is the calling convention? When the function call starts running, where is the argument stored? The argument is stored above the stack pointer. That is the calling convention. So let us go to trap. This struct trap frame, that is this particular value, the pointer TF, you will see now the entries that are mentioned here are in the reverse order of the data that we see here. So you will see entries in trap frame in this order: EDI, ESI, EBP, OAS, PP, and so on. EDI, ESI, EBP, OAS, PP, coming down up to ESP and SS. And you will also see the EIP, CA. So all these things are mentioned here in the struct trap frame. So basically this pointer TF is a pointer to the data on the stack, and you can access all the data onto the stack now using this variable TF. So when you say TF arrow trap number, TF arrow trap number, so that trap number is actually this variable trap number in the structure. Where is it? It is on the stack. Where? How did it come to the stack? With all these pushes, starting from this, when you push this number 0 or this number 1 or this number 2 or this number 3, that was going to become the trap number. So right now we are in the function trap. This is the common function in x86 code to actually handle all traps, that is all exceptions, all hardware interrupts, all system calls, they actually get handled here. So what is this code doing now? It is first of all checking if it was a TSYS call. Trap number was 64. If it was 64, then obviously you came here as a part of a system call. And the thing it does is it calls the function syscall to handle the system call. Otherwise, you will see it does a switch to the trap number. And if the trap was corresponding to a timer, if the switch was corresponding to a timer, it will basically call the function wake up. If it was the hardware interrupt, like the disk interrupt, it will call the function ID interrupt. If it was a keyboard interrupt, it will call the keyboard interrupt function, and so on. Right? In the case of default, that is, you know, this interrupt corresponding to some interrupt which you are not handling, it will call the function panic, which will basically stop the kernel from running. Right? So this is the trap function, which is basically the location where all interrupts actually get handled. What I'll show to you now is some interesting things. For example, if the trap number was the trap number corresponding to the timer. So what is the timer interrupt here? The value of trap number here is IRQ timer. So that is 0, as you can see, and TIRQ 0, that is 32. So basically, if 32 number is corresponding to the timer interrupt, and in that case, what it is doing, it is calling the function wake up. So acquire and release, I know they are not so important functions. It goes to wake up. Wake up, as I see, also does some acquire release, but it calls wake up 1. Wake up 1, as you can see, is basically iterating over the list of processes. Okay, it is basically iterating over the list of processes and making a particular process runnable. Which process runnable? Some process. Okay, the process which matches a particular condition, it is making it runnable. That's it. It is making a process runnable. That is what is happening as a part of this particular piece of code, the timer interrupt. What is happening if you came here as a part of a system call? You will basically call this syscall, and this is the syscall function, and this syscall function you will see is basically, you know, using some data into the syscall array to actually make a syscall happen. So we will come to this later on. But this was largely the overview of how a interrupt handler jumps to the particular interrupt handler code. Okay. This is basically how the interrupt handler jumps to the interrupt handler code. I'll once again revise the concept. The argument to trap is tap frame before the call to trap happened from the all traps code. Okay, there was the push ESP, so the stack had the trap frame pointer. So this trap frame is nothing but the value that was pushed with the push ESP. Remember the calling convention: when a function is called, the stack contains the arguments in reverse order. So basically the trap frame, which is just above the stack pointer right now, is the first argument, and the trap function here will basically get the proper value of trap frame already set up on the stack. So trap function, as we see, has a switch. Okay, and depending on which particular function, which particular interrupt was invoked, it will call all these different functions to do the different type of interrupt handling. Any questions? Rishikesh had a question. Why is there a separate IDT entry for interrupts caused by system calls? Does the system call not use the same entries used by hardware interrupts? Yes. So the thing is here that when the system call is made, you are making a, most typically you are changing from user code to kernel code. Okay. Remember, an interrupt can also occur when you are executing kernel code. Interrupt can also occur when you are executing kernel code. In that case, the privilege level will not change. If you are handling a hardware interrupt when you are executing kernel code, the privilege level will not change. But if you are running a user code and the system call is made, then the privilege level needs to be changed. So the particular entry in the get descriptor, that is the IDT entry for system calls, needs to store the particular DPL value, that is 3. And that is why there is a separate entry made for the IDT. When you do a system call, then necessarily you have to inform the kernel that I am coming from user code. Okay, I thought we'll be able to do this fast, and I'll be able to some other parts of the code also, but I could cover only the interrupt descriptor part. Okay, what I'll do, I'll try to schedule an extra lecture to cover the remaining parts, that is how the scheduler code works, and more typically how the interrupt timer interrupt handler works. We will try to cover those parts also. Maybe I'll try to schedule an extra lecture in discussion with your CR. But I'll take any questions that you might have right now. Okay, I think there will be a lot more questions after you actually go and study the code. Remember, we have not seen a lot of code right now. Okay, we have seen hardly some 100 lines of code. The trouble is because you jump from one file to another file to another file. And I think that is a job best done when you do it yourself. So I would like all of you to actually browse the code right from boot main to entry to main, then to TV init, then to IDT init, and then starting from the code of vector 0 or vector 1 or vector 2, because the code jumps to these directly when there is a interrupt handler. So I'll stop now and we'll continue. Maybe we'll continue in extra lecture this week.